did.
It's not a microphone, it's like audio.
Thank you guys for welcoming us to the Peck Community College. We appreciate it. We had a good afternoon learning a bunch of great stuff from people here about the community and the issues surrounding it. Tonight we're going to have a debate. We're going to have some people for the motion and against the motion. This house supports, or actually for the motion and against the motion. This house supports the Dakota Access Pipeline. We have some wonderful debaters here to argue on both sides, to argue for and against. They don't necessarily agree with what they're saying. They've been assigned it at random, just to get the arguments out there and kind of discuss them with that and figure out where we all stand on the issues. What we think is best for making the world a better place. On the proposition side, we have Eric is a second year at Rocky Mountain College, and Eric, your partner is
Matthew Bowles.
Nice.
Freshman.
For the opening opposition against the motion, this house supports the Dakota Access Pipeline. We have Neighbor Hatcher, a second year English and Sociology major, and your partner is
Eve.
For the second team for the motion, we have Taylor Tate, who's a senior philosophy and a government and politics major at St. John's University. And Taylor, you're joining you in debating will be
Michaela Dean.
Nice. And then the final team against it is we have Cheryl from Rocky Mountain College, who's studying a bunch of things.
Jack, studying communications and political science.
Wonderful. So, without further ado, I think that we can introduce the Prime Minister to give a speech for about 7 minutes.
I just want to say a couple things. So, my name is Steve, I'm from St. John's. So, what your job is tonight, if you're in the audience, is to judge this debate, which means not necessarily who won or lost, but who do you think did the best job of moving you towards their side? So, a lot of times in debate, it's a winner-take-all sort of situation. Like, oh, they totally dominated. And I don't know if that language is appropriate for our contemporary political situation. I think a lot of times, finding some common ground is a good way to think about what we're doing in debate. So whoever moved you in that way, and expressing that to them, and saying, you really moved me to think about things I haven't thought about before, is sort of a good way to debate. So I encourage you to take notes. You can do it on your phone, in your steel trap mind, with pizza sauce on your plate. However you can do it is good. And then at the end, we'll call upon you to say something to the debaters. Either, I really liked this, I thought that was really interesting, or why didn't you bring up this, or why didn't you mention this? So we'll be keeping time, and each speaker will have 7 minutes. They'll go back and forth. It'll be a lot like tennis. They'll kind of hit arguments back and forth to each other down the table. One of the things you might see them do that will confuse you is during somebody's speech, Eve will demonstrate here, I might be speaking as a debater. In the middle of my speech, should I stand up like this? She wants me to yield my speaking time to her to ask a question, to make a comment about how bad my arguments are, or to remind you how good her arguments are during the middle of my speech. It's up to the speaker whether or not they take that point. So if she's up, she stands up and wants to object and demonstrate. He stands up and wants to make a point against me. I don't want it. I can just wave him down like this. If he is persistent, then I can say, okay, go ahead. And then he can say his 20 seconds of happy thoughts about his side of his motion or whatever. Yeah, you're wrong. Thank you. Yeah. And then I have to deal with it as a speaker. So you'll see the speakers use that strategically through the course of the debate. It adds a little bit of fun to thinking like, when a lot of people stand up, they're like, oh, why are they all standing at once? Does that mean it's a really bad point, or does it mean it's a really good point? And they want you, as the audience, to forget about it. So, with that in mind, I guess we'll start the debate. We'll be keeping the time. We'll be giving time signals to the debaters in the form of knocks. And if you hear an argument you like, feel free to clap for it. It's audience participation. So, if someone says something really powerful, let them know it's powerful. You can even do, it's out of the British tradition, knocking on the table. You'll see the debaters do that for each other. As they do, because the form of debate we're doing tonight is British parliamentary debate, which comes to us from the UK. So, So, I think that's it. Enjoy the debate, and afterwards we'll come back up here and ask you guys what you want.
Okay, so there's clearly a lot of controversy regarding the Dakota Access Pipeline. This pipeline, most of the controversy surrounds the fact that it is built right next to Native American land. It's running alongside a river that's, you know, fairly important to them. Unfortunately, the land's been torn up. They've already started the groundwork for this pipeline. And ultimately, it's better to finish it so that this land that has been destroyed has a purpose. Not only do we want to go ahead and finish the pipeline, we also want to focus on repairing our relationships with the Native Americans. The pipeline, it's already torn up the land. That's really, really unfortunate. And all the land that is surrounding the controversy is not really good for much else at this point. There's concrete. Might as well be used. We are going to be the team for better relationships. One of the main purposes of this pipeline is to transport oil. Oil is, you know, a very valuable resource. We trade it with many countries, and we use it for a lot of things, just for transporting ourselves. But also, we currently use it for transporting oil. We're burning oil in order to move this oil, and it's really ineffective. We have this pipeline in place. We can kind of let gravity do all the work and save a lot of money. Now, you might be asking, but where is this money going to go? We think that the money can be put into a couple of things. One is safety. One of the big issues that a lot of people are worried about is what happens if this pipeline busts right by that river. What we need to do is we need to invest some of this money back into safety, reinforce the pipeline, make sure it is sturdy, do everything we can to keep it from busting. But another issue within the oil industry is, you know, the safety of the workers. We can do a lot to keep them safe with the money that we are saving by transporting all this oil via gravity as opposed to, you know, 18-wheelers. But there's one more thing that this money can really...
What guarantee do we have that the oil companies are going to take those savings and reinvest them rather than just line their pockets or cut costs?
We don't have a guarantee, but we are saying we believe this is what should be done. And we are arguing that it's something that can be done, and it's what the U.S. needs to do to enforce. We need the oil industries to be more accountable. We need them to put some of this money back into the pipeline to make it safe. But also, the money could be spent to improve Native American culture preservation. One very unfortunate thing that the United States government has done to the Native Americans throughout the history of the country is oppress them, steal their land, kidnap their children and put them in boarding schools. And it's very, very tragic, and a lot of the culture has been lost because of that. There are a lot of tribes that have, you know, lost their languages. Well, a lot of this money that's being saved by the pipeline, well, we owe some of that money to the Native Americans. We could put that money into building museums and like history museums, so it's easy for people in the tribes to learn the history as well as other people. And we could also put that money into language learning technology, put it into, you know, putting together good translations and the translation dictionaries and applications and such. This will be an opportunity for the U.S. to improve relations with Native Americans, and that's very, very important to us. Our goal is to improve relationships with not only the Native Americans, but other nations as well that we are creating this oil to. Thank you.
So because we believe this, on opposition
despite what Eric has already told you. So first, the idea of this recolonization. So we want to look back at what colonization has been historically, why this would also be colonization. So if you look back at history, what has colonization really been about, right? When people first came to the Americas and they colonized what we now know as the Americas, right? Why did they do this? They do this for wealth. They do this for greed. Why did Christopher Columbus come here? Because he wanted to bring things back to his country, and he wanted to provide back to, like, the royal family and show them to do this in order for him to explore, right? He wanted to go to the Indies, and in order to do this, he had to say that he was going to provide some form of wealth. And what did he do? He went and came and brought back, like, mace and brought spices and all sorts of things that came from the Americas, and this is what they do for colonization, right? Why did they come here? They're trying to make money, to try to resettle these areas and create profit for themselves and profit motives, whether it be through, like, literal countries like Spain comes to the Americas or, like, France comes to the Americas and they settle. We also see that they use companies, right? We see, like, companies who come here, like, British trading companies that came here in the past to do this. This is all for wealth and greed in order to take over land, take over these people for profit, right? We think this is exactly what's happening with the Dakota Access Pipeline now. In this case, we have, like, corporations and in collaboration with the U.S. government in order to make profit off of oil. And how do they do this? They're taking over land that belongs to the Standing Rock tribe in order to do this, right? We also think that this is a problem because this is just people with power and privilege coming and taking over something because they have this power and privilege, right? Why is this an issue now that we're recolonizing these people? We think that this is the same idea or, like, narrative that is passed on that allowed for all of these injustices to occur to Native peoples and different tribes, right? Eric tells you about how all these negative things happen, like boarding schools that they put Natives into, about how we've killed plenty of people in different examples like the Sand Creek Massacre and things like that, right? How is this able to happen? It's because we've done things like this historically that have devalued these people and devalued what their culture means and their land. Directly destroying burial lands and something of cultural significance to these people, and even if it's not of cultural significance, which it is, right, we still think this land is important to them and that this is their sovereign land and it matters because this has to do with their autonomy as people and their sovereignty as people as well, right? So we think that this is bad because it takes away the significance of this and shows that we do not care about these people, right? They'll tell you that they'll get a lot of money and that this builds infrastructure. In fact, Eric did tell you that, right? This gives you money and they can do good things with it. This simply does not happen, right? Because even if we give money to the tribe, right, they're only buying into the system that oppresses them. They're only working with the government that doesn't care about them. Only working with corporations who only care about profit and do not care about their culture and don't care about them as people, right? So we see that this is obviously destruction of their land, so they didn't care about them in the first place, but we see that this, when these businesses come in and these people build schools that they talk about and how we can fund for all of these different programs, we just think that this is a different form of assimilation and erasure of these people's cultures, right? So we think that this is very bad because when you buy into this and only allow to, like, have, like, further oppression of these people. But before this, you have a question.
Yeah, so, like, currently in the status quo, Native Americans are a minority group. They can't just, like, go to war with America. They can't just, like, use, I don't know, some sort of, like, economic capital because they don't have it to, like, make change. So what way do you propose they do it besides working with the system?
Okay, so, like, we don't actually think that this is them working with the system to better their lives. We obviously think that they're just doing this in order to profit for themselves, so this doesn't benefit them in any particular way other than giving them this monetary gain, which will tell you in the long term, right? In the long term, the impacts that happen that are negative are far worse than them getting money now, right, for this pipeline, because this actually doesn't benefit them because it only adds to these ideas that they're worthless and that they don't matter and their land doesn't matter and their culture doesn't matter, which leads to very horrible things in the future, right? So what do we actually see out of this? So in the long term, although they tell you about how they can get money and how we can do these wonderful things, we are going to tell you why that doesn't happen, right? We think that in the long term, this assimilation and destruction of culture leads to a disconnect with these people and their culture. We also think that this leads to, like, self-hate within communities and things like that, right? We think that all of these things are negative because you see this, like, disconnect between them. But also, right, we think that inevitably these pipes will burst or something bad will happen because it's just the nature of how things go. They tell you that we'll, like, reinforce them, but I'll tell you why that isn't true later, right? The government historically does not care about tribes or, like, Native people. Like, we see this over and over again, whether like, even now, the government doesn't particularly care about these people or their issues either, right? So they will not care about them, but even then, in modern day, how do we know that this cultural erasure and them not caring about this and this blatant racism is still going on? Literally, the Dakota Access Pipeline shows you this, because originally the Dakota Access Pipeline was going to be on the other side of the Missouri River, where it goes through Bismarck, North Dakota, which is the capital of North Dakota, and guess what? It's a majority white population, and then those people were dissatisfied because they realized that their water supply could suffer problems as well, and they told the government that they did not like this, and guess what the government did? The government moved the Dakota Access Pipeline to then go through the Standing Rock Tribe's water supply, right? And so they obviously show you that they do not care about these people or these people's health and their water supply at all, right? So what do we get out of this? That they're not going to fix this, and that if there is a pipe burst, which there probably more inevitably will, because these pipes just burst regularly when you see any sort of oil rig or things like that, right? They are going to fix it. They will not care for these people, and they will not have water. And this just shows that we generally don't care about these people, right? But so what does Eric really tell you? He tells you that we can do all these good things. They do not care about these people, so they won't do that. They're not going to reinforce the pipes. They're not going to do any of that because they care about profit. This is just more money that they're not going to give back. Eric doesn't think pragmatically about this. He isn't actually looking at what we see in current day. I'm telling you what we actually see and how we do things, right? What is actually going to happen. That the government doesn't care about these people, and they're not going to do this. And also, he tells you about how this is about we can preserve their culture and do things like that. It already has a purpose. This land is sovereign to them, and we should stop there. If we really want to show that we want good relations with these people, we should stop doing something that they do not like, that doesn't preserve their culture currently. So for all of these reasons, we oppose the Dakota Access Pipeline.
Should be built as fast as possible, and its construction should be reinstated as fast as possible. There are many reasons that we support this pipeline, and before I get into those, I want to go over a few points of rebuttal. So first of all, my opponent got up here and talked about the recolonization of native land, but this is completely false. The pipeline does not touch much native land, if any at all. So it's not recolonizing their land. Second of all, she talks about how the government has not historically cared about Native Americans. Now, this is true, and she talks about how because of the white population of Bismarck, the government changed the route of the pipeline. This is not true. The pipeline is being built by a private company, and the private company changed the route of the pipeline, not the government. There are millions of pipelines. She talks about pipeline bursting, but there are hundreds of pipelines in the U.S., and the amount of them that burst is minimal compared to the amount of them that exist. It does not happen often. They are safe, and they are much safer than transporting oil with oil, which already takes away from the renewable resource that we have. So now, on to my positive matter. The first argument I want to go over is the initial investment of the company building the pipeline. They spend billions of dollars getting licenses to build, buy land, everything. Yes, I'll take your questions.
So are you proposing that we should care more about corporate profits or what they put into this and like people's culture and how we treat people in this country?
I'm saying that no sane American company should have to spend billions of dollars to get a pipeline route approved and then be shut down by executive overreach. That kills hundreds of thousands of jobs, puts people out of work. As I was saying, the pipeline company put billions of dollars towards getting ready for this construction, hiring contractors, buying land, getting the route approved, and then they were shut down by government overreach. This is my next argument. Executive overreach. It was shut down by executive order. This is a huge issue if we care about the rule of law in the United States and our constitutional values. Executive orders are meant as a way to enforce existing laws, not make new ones. And President Obama passing an executive order to stop the construction of the pipeline is a huge overreach of executive power, which should have never been done. This this really is destroying the rule of law in the United States. The next argument is all about foreign policy. This pipeline means that we will be producing more oil in the United States, which will decrease our dependence on foreign oil. We are very dependent on foreign oil currently, and that's the reason that a lot of the wars in the Middle East and the conflicts with Russia and other countries exist. So, before I move on, do you have a question?
Okay, we decreased the amount of oil we were buying from Russia via sanctions, but human rights abuses did not decrease. So why should we expect, if we stop buying oil from the Middle East, why should we expect human rights abuses to decrease when it didn't happen in Russia?
I'm not saying we should expect human rights violations to decrease straw man much. So, as I was saying, this will decrease our dependence on foreign oil, which will lead to more diplomatic, this will lead to more diplomatic relations in many Middle Eastern countries, and we should care about this. This is something that the entire world should care about. The conflicts in the Middle East are, the conflicts in the Middle East affect everyone, and the United States particularly has spent trillions of dollars in the Middle East to only create instability, and though that's a lot of wasted tax dollars that could have gone to other issues.
I would believe that argument if we haven't already seen that Middle Eastern countries can effectively put our companies out of the market. OPEC flooded the market and no one's producing oil in the Bakken anymore, so.
Moving on. So this is something that the entire world should care about because it has a big potential to end the wars in the Middle East and the conflicts in Russia and many other foreign conflicts and potentially bring world peace. So because of executive overreach, because of the initial investment that the company has already put into building the pipeline and the fact that no company should be shut down by executive overreach.
Why should we, deal with these rights and abuses and all these problems in the Middle East or overseas when we don't respect rights at home first?
I'm not saying that we should. So, because of the foreign policy potential of this pipeline and all the other previous reasons that I stated, we urge you to support this pipeline daily.
Institution, in particular when you give them the ability, as Ethan already already told you, to make profit off of these bodies. They're going to see these bodies as profitable, and they're just going to continue on. So you get that cycle on that side. We don't think that a private company is going to care anymore about, like, the rights of Native people. And then he also brought to you that this was an executive order overreach. We don't think that it's a bad thing for the government to act as an actor that cares about Native lands or cares about Native rights. We don't think that's an executive order overreach. We just think that that's being a decent person and, like, realizing that the impacts that you're going to have and that you're being a colonizer and that you're not caring, you're respecting Native lands, and that it's better for the government to act as an actor that supports human rights. And I think that's also contradictory with the point that he just brought to you about the foreign policy and stabilization in the Middle East. Why? Because they told you that if we all of a sudden have less dependence on foreign oil, we're going to get to this ideal dream world and everything in the Middle East is going to be stable and wonderful. And we, like, while we'd love to, for that to be the case, we still think that we see, like, the United States, like, aiding Saudi Arabia and, like, committing war crimes against Yemen, even though Yemen's not even, like, an area that we get oil from. So we think that regardless of, like, we always just are going to put, like, other human rights abuses lower, but we think that just ties into, like, the conflict exists because the government does not care about human rights. When they take executive orders, when they take action to prevent the Dakota Access Pipeline, it shows them caring about human rights. So today I have for you guys the importance of reservations in this search for tribal sovereignty, why it's really important for the government to be the actor that stands up for religious and sacred autonomy for the natives, as well as, like, just some greater impacts about why environmental racism is such a problem and why that's so at key here for the Dakota Access Pipeline. So the first thing is about, like, the importance of reservations. So I just want to thank you guys for allowing us to come to, like, this school today, because we heard and we learned so much from each and, like, every single person that we interacted with today. We heard these personal stories about, like, the community and healing that Native populations have been able to find by being in reservations, by being in Native and tribal college schools. So we think that that community and healing is really important from the historical wrongs that Eve has already brought to you about the historical colonization of these lands. We think that community helps these people feel like they have autonomy and agency, and it's a safe haven for them to go when they've already been oppressed by the outside society and they've told them that they do not matter. So we think that these tribal reservations are important to go to have that community. And we think that if the government steps in and protects these, like, areas from the Dakota Access Pipeline being built there, it's setting precedent for the government to be an actor that cares about the human rights of Native populations, that takes Native population sovereignty seriously, that actually cares about Native populations and following through with the sovereignty that they've agreed to in the United Nations treaties and the United States treaties. And it says that we care about your opinions, we care about the fact that you don't want us to do this, and we're going to take your autonomy seriously. We're going to respect the fact that you have a community on these reservations, and we're going to recognize that, and we think that it's important for the government to do so in order for the government to continue to set precedent and be that actor that respects human rights and respects Native populations. Because we've heard that they historically have not, and we've already heard how dangerous that can be when they don't. So moving on to why, like, religious and sacred autonomy for Natives is so important. So, like, again, with the stories that we heard today, we learned a lot about the healing process and how that goes hand in hand with these protests after the Dakota Access Pipeline. So we've learned that a lot of these protests and a lot of Native individuals attending these protests have been very peaceful, and they've utilized religious tribal dances for healings at these, and they've been praying during these protests and utilizing that, as well as the fact that this pipeline is going through sacred lands and sacred areas that are very important to the Native communities. So we think that if we halt now, even though, yes, maybe we've already started some of it, if we halt now, you're showing respect and following through with the United States principle of, like, freedom for religion for all. And we think that that's obviously something that should apply to you regardless of your religion, regardless of, like, how you identify or how popular that religion is. And we think that that's what's so important about halting now. So we think that it shows respect for Native lands and their sacred traditions. And we're saying that, yes, your land matters. It matters that this land is important to you, and we're going to respect that.
Okay, so it seems like your goal is the same goal as our goal. It's basically, you seem like you want to get some sort of, like, environmental protection for Native Americans, but how do you expect to get there after we just, like, don't continue with the pipeline?
Because you're showing that you're going to stay here. The government's becoming an actor that's not afraid to stand up to, like, private businesses, and they'll actually take a stand for the environment. So we think that you get, like, a better world on our side when the government's not afraid to step in and be that actor that actually cares about environmental protection. So the government takes the environment seriously, you're going to have better outputs on our side. So we think that, again, like, with the historical analysis of, like, the danger that happens when you have a government not accepting or not allowing freedom of religion for all, is that you get things like genocide, you get things like scapegoating. We think that we've already seen those happen, so we shouldn't just, like, not pay pay attention to the fact that these are sacred areas for Native Americans. We think that the government should be the actor to support and respect religion for all, and we think that the precedent that's set, and it's like a way to like historically go against those wrongdoings and say, yes, we see that we were wrong, and now we're going to respect your tradition and have respect for your sovereignty and have respect that this is an important area for you, and as the government, we're taking on that role and taking on that position. So the last thing is just about this environmental racism and how Eves told you that the Florida plan for the pipeline was just to go through these white neighborhoods, and all of a sudden the private company just said, no, we're not going to go through privileged bodies, but we're going to go against those who have been historically disenfranchised in society. So we think that what happens is you're putting the native area and the native populations at a greater environmental risk, which is a problem because there's a likelihood that the pipeline will burst, and we think that there's going to be huge impacts on the community. We think we see the fact that, like, Flint, Michigan still does not have clean water because the government doesn't have an incentive to go in and help, like, bodies that are not incredibly privileged. We think that that's a problem. It's going to impact the community, and that they're not going to have, like, the basic human right of clean water. They're not going to be able to, like, make a meal for their family and have that. They're not going to be able to, like, just go to school. They're going to have to worry about how they're going to have water for that day, and they're going to be at a disadvantage in society when you have to worry about things like getting clean water instead of being able to go and like go to school and go be around your community, go be an active member. So we think that the harms are just too great on their side of hurting national sovereignty, hurting the importance to have a community of those who like have been through and can heal with you. And we also think that you're just hurting the sacred autonomy for Native that's already been ignored throughout history. So for all these reasons, we are proud to oppose.
Issue that we need to like deal with, right? That's like not the current status
How exactly does the pipeline help the help Native Americans gain political power?
That's what I'm going to do. So currently, we have a situation where environmental organizations are working to ensure change. In the last election, we had a situation where many Americans, they wanted to, do things, for the environment. That's, one of the reasons why they voted. They voted based off the environment. So we already have the infrastructure to sort of, get change. And it's sort of, sure that, we don't have, environmental racism like we have in this instance in the, Native American communities with the pipeline. So we already have the infrastructure for that. But we see that a situation where there are barriers for change. And the barriers for change isn't the government. We think that on this side, they're acting as if the government is just this entity that's just, oppressing people. That's not the situation. The government is willed by the people. The government has the will of the people. The way that the government acts is the government acts when the people tell the government to act. And the way that we ensure that we combat, that we eradicate environmental racism is to get the will of the people to try and, we can get them to act. We can get them to move. We believe that we can get them to move, but the only way that we can get them to move is if we ensure economic stability for these people, for, certain Americans. Because I don't think that it's a situation where, these people are just I hate Native Americans or something like that. I honestly don't think that that's the situation. I think that, historically it's been proven that when people are in crappy situations, when people, can't afford to feed their family, when people don't afford to, food to eat or things like that, when they're in that type of situation, and then people ask them, protect the environment, protect this marginalized group, they're going to be like, I don't care. And we think that it's really, really crappy of them to have that situation, have that sort of mindset. It's really, really crappy for them to, be in a situation where, they can't be empathetic unless they're okay. We understand that that's, a crappy situation, but currently that's just the way it works. And the only way to be able to call these people to action, the only way that we can, eradicate environmental justice is if you ensure economic stability for them. And we know that, obviously oil, there's money in oil, there's going to be jobs for these people, in terms of, having a pipeline, and if we have this, it's going to ensure economic stability for jobs within the community, but then it's also going to ensure economic security for people in the United States, because the pipeline is going to, produce, revenue within the United States. Go ahead.
So insofar as the pipeline specifically being built through, minority communities, what is the incentive for them to hire these communities when they already don't think that they deserve, basic human rights, environmental protections? Why would they want to hire them? What's the guarantee there?
So this is what I think that, I don't know if I've been clear about this. I'm not saying that, the Native American people, economic security for the Native American people is just, magically going to, be produced by this pipeline. That's not what I'm saying at all. I'm saying that currently in the status quo, the United States has been able to, define their sovereignty as the ability to, create the rules and enforce the rules and to, say, I don't care about the treaties that I've made in the past. The United States have, defined their sovereignty as, the ability to issue rights and dictate laws in the way that they please. And the only way to combat that is to ensure that the American people rise up and they are called to action and they are called to move and they are called to get out of this sort of mindset where they do actually want to help people, that they vote based on the environment and that they vote based on let's try and what is the best way to ensure that we don't have environmental racism like we have in the pipeline. Because the current situation is that Native Americans, they are a minority. They can't just go to war. They can't just use economic capital because they don't have that to sort of make change. The only thing that they can do is to work through the system. The only thing that they can do is to sort of use American people to sort of create change. And you have this change when you ensure that the American people have economic stability for themselves.
Gentlemen, there are quite frankly far too many harms that this side has to deal with in order to actually justify the creation of this pipeline. There's just too many problems going on. So the main thing that we get out of the last speech was that it's important for the Native American people to gain political capital because that's the only way that they're actually going to be able to really stand up for themselves in these instances. But the pipeline is not really a good way for them to go about gaining political capital through economic stability. This is not going to bring very much money to the Standing Rock Sioux people at all. It's the actual pipeline isn't going to create very many jobs in the construction of it. Only a few thousand temporary jobs and only 40 full-time jobs. And since it's technically not being built on land that's currently held by the Native Americans, no, they're not required by law to hire the Native American people. And so the money likely isn't going to be going to them. And it actually could harm their local economy, because if it contaminates their water, it's going to harm local ranchers because it's going to contaminate the water source that they need to produce their product. Yeah, go ahead.
You interacting with the argument that we actually made, that wasn't the argument we made. We said the pipeline would be better for the United States economy. We think that sort of economic stability is going to ensure and incentivize Americans vote for the environment.
That's a bit of a stretch because, A, the pipeline isn't going to provide that much of a boost for the United States economy, and the idea that people will vote for the environment when they're more economically comfortable has kind of been disproven. Because the people's voting against the environment isn't based in the fact that they're economically uncomfortable. It's based in ideology, right? It's not like people in the global South who are trying to develop their infrastructure because they have no economy. That doesn't really apply to the United States. So the economic viability is actually the first thing that I would like to talk about with the pipeline. In that there is really no good reason that can actually justify the potential harms. All right, and I actually brought this up in a question. Foreign oil has been able to flood the U.S. market and significantly decrease the value of United States oil. So the potential profit to be gained from a pipeline or any of the parts of an oil production is significantly lower than it was at the height of the Bakken boom. All you have to do in order to see this for yourself is drive to where the oil fields used to be, drive to North Dakota, and see that the economic activity there has just plummeted. So, not only to OPEC, oil-producing countries, or whatever that stands for, but also due to the increased viability of alternatives, natural gas, and that sort of thing. The value of U.S. oil is not really going to come back. So the potential profits that we see on their side of the house really is not what we're going to see. It should also be noted that this pipeline is going to be transporting the cheapest type of crude oil imaginable. This stuff is sludge. It has sand in it. You need to put in a ton of money in order to be able to refine it. It's not good stuff. It's frankly not worth the money.
On that one.
And so they're not going to, at best they're really going to make, they're going to break even with this pipeline. If it bursts, they're going to lose money. And on the concept that it's going to create jobs, it's only going to create a few temporary jobs, and then only 40 full-time jobs after that. If it creates more jobs in the long run, it's going to be because the damn thing burst, and you need to hire people to clean up the water and re-weld the pipes and all that stuff. So that's really kind of evens out there. And so the economic viability, the financial viability of the pipeline, all the benefits that they have on their side of the house are frankly minimized by what's happening in the oil economy right now. The second is that this is a really troubling use of eminent domain. Something that hasn't really been brought up so far in this debate is the fact that this was a case where the government used their eminent domain powers in order to create space for this pipeline. For those of you who may not know, eminent domain is the power that the government has to seize private land to make room for things that benefit the national interest, essentially. But there was a Supreme Court case, Kelo versus the City of New London, in which the Supreme Court essentially decided that the government also can seize private land and give it to private companies for development because of the economics benefits everybody. But this has set us down sort of a troubling path where the government can just seize people's private land and give it to developers. This is particularly troubling when reservations are involved. All right? This sets a dangerous precedent for the future. If we allow this to go through, if we say this is an acceptable use of eminent domain, where it violates Native American sovereignty, if we say that that's acceptable, there's nothing to say that seize land that's actually on a reservation currently. There's nothing to say that if we find oil-rich developments on Fort Peck Reservation in the future, people decide that they don't want to allow developers in, there will be no precedent to say that the government can't use eminent domain to seize Native American lands in order to give to oil developers so that they can drill wells and frack and damage the people's local water supplies. This sets a dangerous precedent going forward that not only violates just basic principles of personal property, but Native American sovereign lands as well. There's already been enough time. There's already been enough Native lands taken. First we decide that we're going to put the Native Americans in these little pockets, and then we whittle those down even further. This would be the next way that the government would decrease the size of the reservations. This is an unacceptable precedent to set, and in order for their side to combat that, they need to talk about the economic developments, the potential money that it's going to bring in, the jobs that it's going to create. But I've told you how those benefits no longer exist in any meaningful way that's large enough to justify the potential harms that we have on our side. For all of these reasons, there's no way that we should allow this pipeline to be built. Thank you.
Ensure economic stability. So from that we have the Dakota Access Pipeline ensures economic stability. So that economic stability comes from the Dakota Access Pipeline. It provides work and brings a boom in business and profit. So from that we get the economic stability that leads to less dependency on foreign agencies such as like Saudi Arabia that brings in oil. So this we have more money because we have cheaper oil now that's coming from here. So because of that, we have money that we can spend on other things. So we could fund money for like such as wind and solar power, which is a better power in the long run. So we have money where we could spend money for these powers. So like we could be bringing this money in to spend money on like environmentally friendly sources of energy, therefore not even needing this pipeline in the future, because it's not going to be necessary if we eventually go to these more environmentally sustainable points in the future. So the Dakota Access Pipeline won't even be used to the point that it's going to be like bursting in the future. So we have to look at that. And going off of the point that Jack said earlier, he mentioned that the pipeline
isn't even like economically like good. Why are they building the pipeline if it's not even economically beneficial? So I don't understand that point. I'm also going to take that right now. So the pipeline is being built because it's better for the U.S. economy. We have to look at that and how it's an incentive for people in the U.S. So if it's not good, if like it's not good for the people of the U.S., then why are they building it? And why do they want to build it? The issue right now is the issue of location and where it's being built. That's the reason we're having this debate right now, because of the issue of location. I mean, people want this pipeline. People here on the reservation would want this pipeline if it wasn't being put where it is right now. People don't want it going through that source of water, because where it's going to go through is an issue of where it's going to burst. So, like, we don't want it to be there. So the issue is just moving the pipeline so that it won't be harming people if it does worse in the long run. So we have to look at that and how that could be potentially harmful. So we don't think that we are going to be in this like dream world if we so we want to have like this more environmentally like sustainable future if we
So insofar as we are building this pipeline on like the Missouri River, in the case where it bursts, it probably will, how are we going to put any money into renewable energy when we're putting our money into fixing a leak or building this pipeline in the first place?
Okay, so going off of what my point said earlier, so we're not spending as much money on getting oil from other places such as Saudi Arabia because our oil is cheaper. So we have that money to spend on money such as like solar and wind. So if we're spending that money in solar and wind, if we put all of our money and resources into solar and wind, we won't need that pipeline in like a few years because all of our money will be going into solar and wind power. So if we have that power, we won't need the oil to have that power. So if eventually we all go to solar and wind, we won't need this oil to fund other things. So we think that that's so with that, we're proud to
ladies and gentlemen, this side is going to take the radical position that theft is wrong. And this is really going to sort of build a little bit off my partner's case. Before I get into that, I'm going to address my opponent's points about renewable energy investment. And some of the first initial mistakes that she makes is assuming that the United States is its own economic entity, and that all the money from this pipeline, all of the benefits from this pipeline, are going to be going directly to the United States government, and that the United States government can from there spend that money on renewable energy, okay? So, first of all, the majority of the profits from this pipeline, if there are profits, because we've already brought up debts about technical economic viability, most of the profits are going to be going to private companies, private oil companies. What do private oil companies do with profits? They do two things with profits. First of all, they give them back to the people that own the company. They give them more specifically to the CEOs. Like the average person who works and who is supposed to own shares of the company doesn't get quite as much, but the CEO at the top gets crap tons of money. So that's the first thing that they do. The second thing that they do with, no, not the second. The second thing that they do with the profits from oil is invest in getting easier and cheaper ways to get more oil. They don't invest in renewable energy. Why would I, as an oil company, invest in solar or wind power or hydrogen power when that is going to overcome my oil business, when that is going to overcome my cash cow business that is making me the most money? No, I'm going to focus on pumping as much oil out of the ground and selling it as fast as I possibly can. So, that is the problem with her entire renewable energy argument. First of all, it's not the U.S. government who is doing this. This is a private corporation who has no incentive to improve the environment or to improve the overall quality of our energy sources. And the second thing, the second thing is the economic benefits are dubious to begin with. especially given the fact that it creates very few jobs and the Bakken is dying. Let's be honest. Because of influxes of massive amounts of oil from OPEC, because of the decreased price due to those massive influxes of oil, simple supply and demand, increased supply, decreased demand, decreased price. So we're seeing that the price of oil decrease, the Bakken's no longer sustainable, profits no longer coming from the Bakken. So now I'm going to address this using a two-world scenario. Now, this is the world of the opposition and the world of the government. And I'm going to focus on three simple areas that I believe that we win on. First of all, what does the world of the government look like as far as economic benefits go? So, we see an increase in 40 permanent jobs and a couple thousand temporary jobs. Temporary jobs that are not going to necessarily go to people on tribal lands. They're not going to go to Native Americans, not going to go to the people who are going to be hurt. So, in this way, it doesn't benefit tribal lands. The second thing that we see on the economy, no, not this time, the second thing that we see on the economy is that damages to the environment are going to cost even more money to tribal lands to fix up. The corporations, well, yes, you can take money from them for violating environmental laws. You can take money from them and try to put that back into it. But the burden of the cost is mostly going to fall on the tribal governments of the sovereign reservations that they're damaging most. The costs will fall partially on the federal government, partially on the companies, but the heaviest cost will fall upon those who do not have the resources, the Native Americans themselves. So, what do we see with the economy over here? We see instead of investing this money in the pipeline, instead of encouraging investment in a pipeline that, first of all, isn't going to generate much revenue, second of all, is going to actually economically harm in the long run, instead, we see us trying to invest more in renewable energy. And while that cannot be a solid point on our side, we see that with the entire lack of benefit on their side, we can point to that as, at very least, we're breaking even. At very least, those guys are harming the tribes and harming the economy of the whole of the area. I'll take one.
Just as the government used overreach to stop the production of this pipeline, used that overreach to help the Native Americans preserve their culture that we have systematically destroyed.
Not approving a pipeline that they have the very authority to choose to approve or not is not overreach. They had the authority to not approve the pipeline. They executed that authority. It is not an overreach of executive power. They used a power that was delegated to them validly by Congress. Okay, so the second part of this two worlds scenario is what happens to tribal power. And we get a little bit of this out of top government. On this side, we see tribal power decrease. Now, they talk a lot about how it's going to increase political capital, but I fail to see how allowing a private corporation with the sanction of the U.S. government to steamroll over popular opposition within a tribe, I fail to see how that builds any political capital, how that in any way helps the tribes push their issues and helps the tribes fight back against overreaching corporations and an overreaching government. I fail to see how that helps. So on their side, we see a ceding of power to the government and a ceding of power especially to private corporations. Now, we spoke a little bit about this with the eminent domain issue. Now, this cedes power even more to the local government because it sets this precedent that the government can seize lands for economic development and for natural resources from tribes, directly violating their sovereignty and harming the tribe as a whole. Now, the third and final part that I believe that we really hit home on is individual landowners. How does this affect individual landowners? Because these guys, they're happy to say that the government can take your land, that the government can use it for the benefit of a private corporation, and this is going to harm individual landowners within the tribe and without. You are taking money, you are forcing them to sell, you're forcing them to sell family farms, you're forcing them to sell burial ground, essentially, and you are forcing them to cede their own private land that they may hold dear. You are harming the individual landowner just as much as you are harming the tribe as a whole. Overall, we can see that their benefits are built on sand. We can see that their harms are palpable, and we can see that on our side of the house, we are the defenders of the environment. We are the defenders of tribal sovereignty, and we are the defenders of the individual landowner. Ladies and gentlemen, theft is wrong, and we are against theft. Thank you very much.
Okay, so that is what a debate looks like in the British parliamentary style. You've all sort of seen it, parts of it, the whole thing. I guess what we'll do now is get comments from the audience of what you thought or what your reactions are to what you saw. Yes, sir.
You suck.
What do you mean by shocked?
Yeah, I have to say this team over here definitely did their homework, and was definitely, this young lady here was definitely, how would I say it, exuberant in her expressions in the debate. Yes, I was really impressed with that. As far as this team goes, I thought they were really hesitant on some of their facts and expressing some of their facts. There's a lot of ums and pauses and stuff like that. So I really don't think you guys were as strong. You could have researched a little bit more. There are a lot more facts out there that you guys could have used in your arguments. And I could probably tell you about some of those. But other than that, yeah, this team definitely hands down.
Thank you. I'll just make some comments. This is the first time I've ever seen an actual formal debate. I think each and every one of you did really great. There was just because the issue is kind of near and dear to my heart as well. I'm kind of like David, have a little bit more insight into some of the facts that maybe you guys are privy to, but. In addition to some of the arguments that you guys made in opposition, I think there was some legal arguments you guys talked about, like the environmental impact study that was originally approved, and then for whatever reason there was an executive decision through the Army Corps of Engineers, I believe, to kind of sidestep that. But that was, I think, kind of a major point that was probably missed. I really like the second speaker's points regarding colonization and culture. You really were very passionate about that. And then providing examples about pipelines breaking and how it's just like inevitable. It's basically a cost of doing business, which I think was something that was, I think, a powerful statement to make. The third speaker, I thought it was good. I didn't agree with some of it, but I think it was good that they brought up the fact that there was executive overreach, establishing the rule of law, and articulating how it's creating a dependency on foreign oil. So I thought that was good. The fourth speaker, I apologize, I don't know if you guys have my name, even though I was introduced earlier, but the fourth speaker, I really like the fact that you brought up respecting tribal population and sovereignty. Could have elaborated on the fact that the Dakota Access Pipeline, its opposition is probably bigger than just tribal populations, Fort Peck or Standing Rock. It's really like a national and international issue. There was like the investment movement through a lot of the financiers, like Wells Fargo is kind of one, just because on social media. Literally, I think billions of dollars have been pulled out of it. So I think referencing stuff like that would kind of strengthen your argument. The fifth speaker mentioned economic security, like I believe the second one did as well. I thought that was a good point to make. Very passionate. I thought that was really good. Another thing I think that could have been articulated was that tribal governments in general were not really consulted in the process. It wasn't, all the easements weren't approved before they even started building it, so maybe you guys did mention it and I just kind of missed it. pipeline, you say it's, while it's not being built on private land, I think technically it's one of those arguments. It was technically on like a disputed treaty territory. So I think that's something you could probably mention.
Historical land.
Yeah, what do we mean when we say tribal land? Like, yeah. Some people would say North America.
Yeah.
other people would say places like Fort Peck.
Yeah,
and then there's a number of gradations.
Yeah, you say like
a virtual reservation.
Yeah. Oh, tribal land, you mean Canada. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, there was a great Sioux, you know, territory, the 1958 Fort Laramie Treaty. I mean, you could reference stuff like that. Speaker number 7, economic viability. I think you were passionate about that. That was a good point. And the 8th speaker did really well. The renewable investment counterculture. I wrote that note down. But that was good. Private interest as opposed to government. That was really good. And then the OPEC, you both mentioned that. That was kind of flooding the market. Me and this guy sometimes blabber about geopolitics a little too much.
I'd say like one thing, you guys, could you use the fact that there's more than one reservation in North Dakota that actually Fort Belknap has 1,000 fracked wells on it. And you guys really have to research for this, but they got 1,000 fracked wells on it. They have plans for $400 million gasoline factory there, what do you call that, a refinery, and they actually have plans themselves to put a pipeline to that refinery underneath the same river. So it's not as much unity in the Indian world, especially in North Dakota, as people actually believe that there is. In fact, even the same here, we have fracked wells all over the place here too. Another one is that most people don't know this, that the pipeline route that they're already taking right now, there's already a pipeline underneath that. In fact, there's two of them. And they're just following right next to the other ones. And those ones have not burst either. So that was another argument you guys could have done if you would have researched more. So there's, just a little bit more in your guys' argument if you guys would have just researched a little bit more. But yeah, like I said, 1,000 fracked wells, where was it? I always like to say, it's like, where was everybody at when these 1,000 fracked wells on Fort Belknap were being drilled? There was no protest, there was no sign waving, there was nothing. I kind of find that shameful myself, but that wasn't a big thing because the Indians there at the time, were like, give me the money. They were, and they're still giving me the money, and they're still taking in hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars every year on the reservation over there.
Yep, in the back.
The debate,
well, let's see. We were told a few days ago that we would be debating.
When did we get that?
Right, like on the plane.
Why you told us on the plane?
I think I might have told you on the plane.
So yeah.
What side we were on?
Yeah, but as far as the sites go, it's arbitrary.
Right.
So it switches around quite a bit. Yeah, but I remember it was like, we flew out here, Monday? Yeah. So it must have been Thursday night, I guess. I might have said.
So,
maybe on the
there is a lot of disinformation out there.
Yeah.
Sovereign nation. We feel like you're thinking that we had our own laws, our own personal governments, and we were allowed this, and that's the way I look at it. But, with the Army Corps, there's private investors also. It's kind of pretty much all set up, and they're going to do what they want to do, right? And that's why it's just, and I know that Trump was one of the investors. All about the money. I want to know the question I'm asking is, who cleans up, or how do they find out when one of those pipes do burst?
Yeah.
It not only affects our native people there, but the water that goes down,
Yeah, I think that's a good example from something. I teach argumentation and debate. I don't teach environmental law or anything like that. From the perspective of debater trying to get people to assent or be persuaded, a lot of times our initial reaction is to go for the big claim and say the pipe is going to burst, oil everywhere, and then all of our minds go to things like the oil-covered birds from tanker spills and oil waves on the beach, and we get those horrible images. But in this case, it might not be the best way to go because the slow leak and the person who believes, like we all do, they have faith that what's coming out of the tap is clean and safe. And if there's a slow leak, how do we detect that? How do we know that until 20 years down the line when they develop breast cancer?
A drop in pressure.
Or a drop in pressure
in the oil pipeline.
I mean, is the pipeline as safe as railroad cars?
And that was the argument that these two guys made.
Right.
That was kind of forgotten, which is, right. It reminded me of another natives debate, which is the Yucca Mountain debate, about nuclear waste storage from way back when, 2001 or something. President Bush was like, we're going to open up the Yucca Mountain nuclear waste storage facility. Although that, I mean, again, what's tribal land? This is a religious and historical site for natives. We're going to store nuclear waste there. But then there's a fault line there. So the government's argument in that case well, it's better than transporting the nuclear waste by rail. And then they came up with a great line. You have mobile Chernobyl. Whoa, right? You're going to take it, I mean, that like it rhymes, makes you think of the horrors of Chernobyl. But we don't really have that for this, but that slow sort of impact, the oil pressure in the pipeline. But what's a big drop in pressure? Is there an industry standard for that?
Well,
what's a drop in pressure? Do we know what that looks like? How do we know there's like, how much is it? How much is a leak measured, right? And so this creates a kind of doubt in the mind of the audience that is incredibly persuasive. We won't know until your loved ones are dying from cancer 20 years from now that the pipeline leaked into the.
I mean, we're just here on Fort Peck Lumber, we're facing from oil wells that they drilled in the 50s that have leaked into our water supply. And it took 20, 30, 40 years for it to actually even get to here from 10, 20 miles that way. And, you know, the government ended up having to give us a water plant and do all this stuff so we could have drinking water here.
Yeah.
So, what are the frack wells? You know, they're dumping chemicals in there. They're secret. You know. So, a lot of them say there's radiation in it.
Hey.
So, yeah. So.
Did you want to say anything else?
Yeah. The airship was talking about the learning from the government, they can't teach you how to, whatever, you gotta go out and learn for yourself or whatever happens, so on and so forth. Yeah, we can do all of that, but they're still gonna do what they wanna do. Might not be on travel, I'm gonna reach out to them to it. We had this long time for our rights, for the water boots. Kept clean, and they still released the judge released that go ahead, keep digging. Where does it end? They violated pretty much every treaty, so why do we trust the government anymore? You know what I'm saying? It's just like we have no rights. And when you say sovereign nation, that's questionable too.
I'm just going to make one other comment.
There's another pipeline, this Keystone Pipeline. It's Rawa. I think it was approved. I'm not double sure on that, but it's just north. It's similar to Standing Rock, where it enters over there.
Mm-hmm.
Just above the reservation here upstream. I think it's over by Wyota. I mean, right north of the reservation.
Yeah. Is
where it's scheduled to go underneath. So it's a very similar issue.
Right. It's actually going to go right off the end of the reservation here. And just like they're doing over there, it's like a quarter mile to a half mile away from the reservation boundary line. That's Keystone, but they lost their permits on that a couple years ago, so they would have to totally do that. One thing on that is they've already shot those pipelines east and west. Mm-hmm. So really that might not even come to fruition. They said it would take at least another 5 to 7 years for them to even to get back up to speed on applying for permits and all the stuff that they would need, go back to these landowners and say, we'd like to put a pipeline through your land now, you know, because, and they'd have to repay them because now those leases are null and void, you know, so Keystone might not even actually happen. So, and that's even, that tar sands well is even asking for the stuff that's being drilled over in North Dakota right now, so that's the real mess.
Steve, I think this guy's
good. Actually, Senator John Tester was here visiting with the tribal council on a Saturday about 3-4 weekends ago, and it was to renegotiate talks about where this pipeline should be laid. If right now, like he was saying, it's supposed to be on the west end, just a few miles off the reservation. And so the tribe was kind of talking about how they want to move it on the east end. Maybe on the reservation to try and get some money, or off. But it's still an effect of like downstream.
Right.
Yeah. So that's, it's just back up for negotiation.
Yeah. I mean, I think when we're arguing about these things, something to keep in mind is that a lot of times you're dealing with systemic problems like water, air, soil, and time. There's a way of thinking that's called, it's environmental thought called the precautionary principle. Some of you might be familiar with this kind of reasoning, which is that instead of determining our choice based on the risk of something happening, when we're talking about environmental things, we should base our decision based on the reversibility or the ability to clean up what has happened. And if that is incredibly difficult to do, and that has lasting harms that can't be changed, then even if the risk is low, you would still decide not to do it. And that's what the precautionary principle is. So most of the time when we make decisions, human beings are like, well, what's the risk of the bad thing happening? And then we make our decision based on that, right? But then when we change our thinking and say, well, let's think about the impact, the bad result if something did happen. Let's take risk out of it and make our decision based on the impact. If the impact's not reversible, if you can't clean it up, if it has harms that can't be cured or fixed in a reasonable way, then you would just not do it no matter the risk. Right? So it's a different kind of reasoning that we're not used to doing. This is kind of what you're speaking it to, is like whether the pipeline is there or not, the environmental impacts still come, and that's where we should make the decisions. Your argument's rooted there, whereas somebody like the senator or the tribe would say, well, what's the risk of something bad happening? We have to change the rhetoric to, but if the bad thing happens, can we fix it? Can we fix it?
Yeah,
I mean, I think that's precautionary principle rhetoric. For sure, it's great. I mean, it's interesting. Like, we have a lot of different ways to parse things, and I think sometimes we don't think about the ideology that's given to us about how to think about things. A lot of times it's a corporate ideology, right? Risk-reward, investment profit, investment return. And it's just infected our language and thinking to a level where we can't even question it. But there are many different opportunities available to us as thinking people. How do you make decisions about what we do? But we easily let those norms of corporate life sort of infect how we think and talk and decide these things. As somebody who studies this stuff, that's fascinating to me. How little space there is to interrogate that. So it's a good point. It makes me think about this stuff. It's good. I mean, I'm no environmental expert, but I do like thinking about how people make arguments. People think it's weird. I'm not terribly interested in like the truth or the reality of it, but how people get to believe that there's a true reality. That's why I say it. So people are like, you're a weirdo. And I'm like, yeah, but it's just fascinating. Like, here's a U.S. senator who's like, water is life, but you can make a few $1,000 when you put this pipeline there. You know, and it's like, how do you put that in your head? How do you keep those two things in your head?
Yeah.
Already signed an executive order saying that they were going to essentially fast track reapproval of the Keystone pipeline. So, if a Democratic senator like John Tester was coming to try to negotiate where the pipeline went, I mean, the pipeline being built to him may have been just a foregone conclusion. And the best we can do is try to move it. I mean, if try to move it so that your tribe isn't necessarily adversely affected. Yes, the people downstream still gonna be screwed. I mean, but you're already getting screwed from the north with the fracking that's harmed the aquifers up north. I mean, eliminating one of your other sources of water, at least moving it east of you, would keep you from being pinched on both sides from both sources of water. And not to be a tester apologist, but I mean, there's reasons why even the most liberal senators, given the current administration, and it's in his ball court, it's in the administration and the executive branch's court to approve or to not approve of the pipeline. That's their power. Then the best he can do is try to negotiate some way to mitigate that harm. I mean, it's small consolation, especially for the people downstream, but
that's a debate in itself, executive orders.
I have family downstream. A lot of people have family downstream. I don't want this get into our water intake, which is put into our homes. I don't want that to happen to my family, my children, and my grandchildren. Why would I let that happen to somebody else? You know, even my family was in Santa Cruz. I don't have family there, but still, I wouldn't want to see that. You know, it's like thinking for everybody, not just your
anybody else
want to
say anything?
I'd like to go to the legality of the argument earlier about Obama's decision. Of course, the president has, I'm going to say in favor of his decision for the simple fact that the president has plenary powers to make executive orders when it comes to the security of United States citizens. And if he thinks that pipeline is against the security, it's going to harm American citizens. He has the executive power to make those decisions. Just like every president has the executive plenary power to protect the citizens. So,
and specifically in this case, the EPA and the Army Corps of Engineers. I mean, specifically, that's it. That's if you're looking for a legal justification, then the act establishing the Environmental Protection Agency and the act establishing the Army Corps of Engineers, those are usually
to protect the United States.
Yes, and then the justification behind those laws and the justification behind that decision. Right. So in any case, the decision was correct, was justified legally and justified morally or public interest wise.
I think that's a good debate in itself. It's just basically executive powers.
Yeah, it's one that comes up a lot. We do that one a lot.
Oh, you guys do?
Not these people per se.
Right.
A couple of years ago, there was a debate we did at the Franklin Roosevelt Presidential Museum, FDR Museum in New York, and it was about the executive powers of the president, how far they go, how far they ought to go. It's pretty interesting. It's really a good one to think about.
I think
I'd like to see that one.
Yeah. Well, my YouTube channel.
I'm done now, yeah.
You go watch find my YouTube channel. Yeah. There's two things on it, lots of debates and lots of video game videos. So you can just choose which playlist you like.
Well, this is the second debate I've watched in the last couple of weeks. Of course, I watched Ted Cruz and
Bernie Sanders debate.
Sanders debate, and of course, Ted Cruz slaughtered him all over the place. You know, that was quite interesting.
You thought Ted Cruz did well in that?
Okay, of course, Ted Cruz is a debater from college himself. So,
yeah.
I mean, when we look at
Ted Cruz is so evil, though.
He's articulate.
Yeah.
All the people, governments, that
are. Does his homework.
Oh, yeah, he's smart.
Part of the government?
Yeah. like executive overreach. We could say, yeah, maybe that's bad, maybe that harms normal functioning of government, but how does that compare to the other bad things in the debate, like environmental damage? And like, a lot of times audiences want to know which one is worse. This is why I like this argument that they brought up about the transporting it on the road and how dangerous that is. You know, there's an argument you could make to say, look, you know, oil use is inevitable, our demand for oil is coming up, and it's all bad. There's always going to be environmental impacts and terrible things. This debate is about which ones we can actually live with and which ones we can't. And we're going to say the pipeline is much, much better than the current ways of getting this kind of oil to refineries and dealing with it. They can make that kind of an argument too. But I think if they're going to make the overreach argument, you have to explain why we want to accept those environmental impacts to preserve this kind of interpretation of executive authority. I think that has to be made if you hope to persuade the audience. Because they're going to say, well, overreach, yeah, that's bad. But then you start thinking about it, you're like, yeah, but, I mean, people dying from things that could have been prevented, or environmental harms we can't clean up, that maybe it's and that's not clear. It's how people decide, right? So.
Also, on the risk of transporting via rail or via truck, I mean, in that case, yes, there's a higher risk of any individual truck breaking and, like,
yeah,
individual truck spilling. The risk is still relatively low. But with a pipeline, like, if one truck or two trucks spill and break, then you've got that limited amount of oil that is being spilled on the ground and possibly harming the environment. Versus if a pipeline breaks, the amount of oil going through that pipeline and the time that it takes to fix that pipeline, I mean, an enormous amount more oil is going to be spilled through that continuous push of oil through the pipeline. So
yeah, I think we can
feel the turn out with the wash.
Yeah, I mean, this is a good example. We can feel the pull towards that of being like, that's right. And constructing it like that, with that kind of, those kind of statements, makes it feel very real. We can do the same thing on the other side of the trucks and the trains and all that, depending on how we articulate. But that's a great example of doing that kind of comparison that I think needs to happen more in the debate to help the audience decide. But that's a great example of how to do that.
Steve, this gentleman's been very patient. He's
the same. Oh, you want to say something?
Yeah, now you took both of my words already.
Oh, sorry. I get accused of this a lot.
No, one of my questions was, what was your YouTube thing again?
I can write it down for you, but yeah, it's like, I don't know, I'll have to look it up on my YouTube. It's just my name, probably. So it's like Steve L. My last name L L A N O.
No, and then like one thing, actually, like, we didn't really talk about like them as much as we talked about them. But one thing that she, I think it was her on the third, or you, one of your two, they kind of disclaimed what she said, and it was about how like one of them two had talked about how the population, I think it was in Bismarck, was predominantly white, so that's why the government stopped it or whatever. Then she, like, because I was going with her first, like, because she was very articulate in her speech. So once she said that, that kind of made me like, hey, you know, maybe all her facts isn't straight. And that's one thing that people don't always go by. Like, they hear something and they just be like, oh, maybe this is this, instead of going back and checking the facts.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great point. There's two dangers to thinking that we face big time in our world. And the first one is confirmation bias. I don't know if you've ever heard of this phenomenon before, but it's really hypercharged when we live in the world of Googling everything. I don't know who won Best Album last year, right? The Grammys were just on TV, right? Let me look it up. Google. Confirmation bias says that if you're researching something, you're more likely to prefer information that already conforms to your belief, regardless of how much research you've done to confirm that belief. Your initial feeling will always filter the kind of information you pull into your case, whether you're writing a paper, whether you're trying to argue with your friend about sports or anything. Your initial feeling will govern how much you discredit what you're reading and how much you calcify it. Like an oyster with a grain of sand, you calcify it so it doesn't irritate you and push it out. So in the world of Google, who makes their money based on getting you to click more, confirmation bias becomes incredibly dangerous. Because you Google a thing and you start to click on things that already support your belief, transportation. Those are the things that appeal to you. Then what's Google going to show you? More links that conform to what you've clicked already. It hypercharges, exponentially powers you through that. That's one danger that we have to figure out how to mitigate as people who are research, you know, concerned citizens want to engage and make sure we get our facts straight, which I think is a good thing to say in a world where people are like, we're post-fact, or alternative facts, or these are the facts and the alternative facts. Getting our facts straight, I think, is an interesting gesture back to Aristotle, who, your favorite, who said that, he was talking about how one of the things we don't want is a warped ruler. We don't want to warp the ruler before we measure. And so sometimes, you know, you do that. So getting it straight, making sure it's good. We can't necessarily know if we have the best facts. We can help get them straight. And the second thing is this great book that just came out a couple years ago called Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow, which was, I forget the author's name, but you can Google it. And the book Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow is a consolidation of a lot of social psychology thinking and about there's two different ways of thought, system one and system two, that humans engage in. System one thinking is our biological, evolutionary thinking of quickly interpreting something as dangerous or not and running from it, which is the root of things like, yeah, essentialism, racism, stereotyping, and that's system one thinking, which has served us incredibly well for hundreds of thousands of years. And so that's hard to mitigate when we now are in a society much different than that, where we want system two thinking, which is pause, reconsider, get our facts straight, examine all the, be slow, and be uncertain. And people are very comfortable with uncertainty and slowness. We're like, look at the facts, make a decision, let's get going. Why is our government so slow? Why aren't they doing anything? Let's get it done. And that's system one thinking, influencing the decision of like what rationality and reason would have us do, which is be slow, be methodical, take your time, give a decision. So that whole book, Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow, is about these two systems of thought that are both good, but how do we make sure that they don't overdetermine the other? Sometimes system two is very bad and can cause a lot of trouble when we need system one thinking. So this book is a good one. I recommend you read that and read anything you can on confirmation bias. But I don't know how to tell you to do that without coming to confirmation bias by clicking the things that already support your belief about what confirmation bias is. It's like Inception.
What was the name of the
book? Thinking Fast, Thinking Slow. Did anybody
know the author? No, I have your YouTube
though. That's good. What's the YouTube address?
It's just your name.
Yeah, youtube.com/Steve Yana.
S-E-E-L-L-A. Or just look in the YouTube search bar.
Oh, yeah, just put my name in the YouTube search bar. You'll see all my great PS4 videos and my debate and lecture videos, which I probably should take those.
Put them separately.
Videos all
no, I'm sure it's connected. It's all rhetoric.
And you like Comic Con in there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, my vlogs from New York Comic Con. You can watch that. So, gotta love New York Comic Con. It's great.
How long are you guys going to be here?
We're going. Where are we going tomorrow? We're going around here somewhere tomorrow.
We're going to Box Elder.
Box Elder?
Yep.
And then tomorrow night we're going back to Billings, and then we're flying back to New York on Sunday, so we have a couple more days in Montana to kind of chill out.
Well, the only reason I'm asking is I've been following this guy, John Bolba, who's a
What is the film called?
John Bolivar, he's called the big oil whistleblower that you lab still part of.
Cool, thank you.
So yeah, I'm trying that side just to, you know, let the people aware of what can happen and what has happened.
What's the guy's name again?
John Bolenbaugh, B-O-L-E-N-B-A-U-G-H. How do you spell your last name?
Me? It's L-L-A-N-O. I can give you a card. I can give anybody this one if you want to.
I got this card. I'll send it out to the students.
Okay.
Yeah. If you ever want to email me. I love email. I make tons of email every day. No leaks, no spills. The email pipeline is secure. So.
Except for the NSA. It's not that secure.
Except for the NSA.
NSA.
Oh, man.
They want to read my stuff more about them.
Yeah. I have a VPN. I protect myself.
Oh, nice.
Well, yeah, well, this is an example of one kind of debate. Yeah, this is an example of one kind of debate you can do. You can engage. One of the things I always like to leave audiences with is the idea that in our culture, United States culture at this time, we tend to think of debate as something we do after we've gotten all the facts. But what if we were to debate to determine what we don't know? And I think that's a real powerful... We saw a little bit of that tonight, where people commented and said, well, you know, you guys know about this, you know about that. And it makes all of our viewpoints stronger when we come together as a community. So having a debate when we're not certain of what we know is actually much better than having it when we think we have all the facts and we come and debate's the place where our rightness is going to... Our truth is going to shine. I don't know if that's the best way to think about debating, and I'm not even sure that that's the way that the history of the country went with debating. Debating was often done a lot when people didn't know what the right thing was to do, with a lot of questions in United States history. So I'd encourage you to have debates when you're not certain, and then it helps you see what you don't know. And then it also encourages you to go read about it so that you can be right. Everybody loves to feel right. And there's nothing better than debate to make you feel oh so wrong and terrible about yourself. You immediately want to go patch it up by reading about stuff that's like, that's not going to happen again. Off you go. And I really think it's a powerful tool for determining knowledge. What counts, what should count. Instead of the way it's kind of trivialized in our society, is like, only when you know the truth should you debate. That's absolutely wrong. So... thank you guys for coming.
Thank you guys for coming.
Thank you guys for coming.